Hi. Let's talk about the aerodigestive pathway with a special emphasis on the digestive portion of this pathway. So the aerodigestive pathway consists of all of the structures that are common between the respiratory and the digestive systems. So these would include the mouth, the oral or buccal cavity, and the pharynx or the colloquially throat. And in particular, because we're focusing on the digestive portions of the aerodigestive pathway, we're going to look at the oropharynx and the laryngopharynx. The mouth, or the oral opening, is the space between the lips. Now, this space is controlled by a muscle called the orbicularis oris. And it can be further modified by other muscles of facial expression. Now, what's important to realize is that all of these muscles are under control of cranial nerve 7, or the facial nerve. In order for you to move the mandible, or to participate in a process known as mastication, we need to bring in innervation from another nerve, which would be the mandibular nerve, commonly known as V3, which is the third portion of the trigeminal nerve, or cranial nerve number 5. Beyond the mouth is the oral cavity. And the oral cavity has two major spaces. First, there's the oral vestibule. The oral vestibule is the space that is outside of the teeth and the gingiva. So this space is a rather minor portion of the total oral cavity, but it is important because ingested fluids and materials do make their way here. And there's also secretion from one of the major salivary glands called the parotid gland into the oral vestibule. So the openings of the parotid ducts are located there, just adjacent to the maxillary second molar. Beyond the oral vestibule, we have the teeth, which are important for physical digestion, that are supported by the bones of the maxilla and the mandible, and surrounded at their roots by your gums, or your gingivae. Beyond the plane of the teeth and the gingiva is the oral cavity proper. And that oral cavity proper is going to contain the tongue, as well as the openings for the submandibular gland ducts and the sublingual gland ducts, which are going to open at the floor of the oral cavity proper. The oral cavity proper is going to extend posteriorly to the palatoglossal arch. That palatoglossal arch is the division between the oral cavity and the oropharynx. Now, teeth are important structures for physical digestion. They incise, they tear, and they grind materials brought into the oral cavity. Now, you can conceptualize teeth as existing in four quadrants. So your maxilla is going to host two quadrants of teeth, and the mandible is also going to host two quadrants of teeth. There are two types of teeth. There are deciduous or milk teeth. Deciduous teeth are those that erupt after birth and then begin falling out of the gingiva at approximately 5 years of age and beyond. In terms of the deciduous teeth, there are 20 total, and in each quadrant, an individual is going to typically have two incisors, one canine, and two molars. So 5 per quadrant, 4 quadrants for 20 total. In terms of your adult teeth, these are the teeth that typically replace the deciduous teeth. Individuals will typically have 32 teeth. In each quadrant, this corresponds to two incisors. And we can see the incisors here. There's a central incisor and then a lateral incisor. The incisors are flanked by the canines, and there is one per quadrant. And then looking at this laterally, canines are then flanked by two premolars, typically, and then there are three molars. Many individuals may have variation with respect to the molars. They may only have two. Some individuals may opt to have their third molar, oftentimes referred to as the wisdom tooth, removed to prevent any issues of crowding. Also within the oral cavity proper and the pharynx is the tongue. The tongue is a muscular structure that is highly kinetic or mobile within the oral cavity and the pharynx. It helps us to move food materials. It also helps us to experience the sensation of gustation or taste complements of gustatory receptors that may be distributed upon papillae of the tongue. These papillae may take the form of fungiform papillae, which are larger mushroom-like eruptions. The fungiform papillae are responsible for hosting the lion's share of gustatory receptors. More ubiquitous than the fungiform papillae are smaller filiform papillae distributed throughout the tongue or taste buds. Filiform papillae typically do not host gustatory receptors, and oftentimes people may mistakenly refer to the papillae themselves as taste buds. There are also folate papillae on the sides of the tongue. These may host gustatory receptors, but they typically only do so in childhood, and then they diminish as a person ages. And then there are also valate papillae, sometimes referred to as circumvallate papillae, towards the posterior portion of the body of the tongue. Now, with respect to the tongue, there are two major portions. There's the body of the tongue. The body of the tongue is the portion that you most typically will see. This extends back to the terminal sulcus. And then there's the root of the tongue, or the pharyngeal portion of the tongue, that exists beyond the palatoglossal arches. So those palatoglossal arches are the division between the oral cavity and the oropharynx. So the body of the tongue exists in the oral cavity, whereas the root of the tongue exists in the oropharynx. Now, with respect to the innervation of the tongue, there are a couple of different innervation components. So there would be the somatic muscular control of the tongue. This is controlled by the hypoglossal nerve, cranial nerve 12. There's also going to be somatic afferent, or the sensory portion, that which you can feel from the tongue. For most of the tongue, so up to the valate papillae, this is going to be modulated by the lingual nerve, which is a part of V3. In areas posterior to that row of valate papillae, it's going to be the glossopharyngeal nerve. Which is cranial nerve 9. Now, in terms of special senses, in particular, taste, we're going to see a very similar pattern of innervation. The majority of the body of the tongue is actually going to be innervated by chorda tympani, which is of the facial nerve, cranial nerve 7, by way of the lingual nerve. So those fibers are going to hitchhike on the lingual nerve. Whereas the valley papillae and posterior are going to be innervated for taste via the glossopharyngeal nerve. There are large aggregations of lymphatic material along the root of the tongue. This is referred to collectively as the lingual tonsil, and it's restricted to the pharyngeal portion of the tongue. Beyond the oral cavity, so in regions beyond the palatoglossal arch, we have the pharynx. As you may recall, the pharynx consists of a nasopharynx, an oropharynx, and the laryngopharynx. The oropharynx is going to be the space between the soft palate and down to the line of the epiglottis. So this is going to be contiguous space of the pharynx and the oral cavity. So food materials are going to pass into the oropharynx. And then they'll move into the laryngopharynx. And it's at this point of the aerodigestive pathway that materials may either move anteriorly into the larynx and then the trachea beyond, which would be the respiratory system, or posteriorly into the esophagus. The transition from the laryngopharynx into the esophagus begins at the inferior border of the cricoid cartilage. So that's approximately at the level of C6. So we've discussed the areas from the mouth through to the opening of the esophagus. Let's now move on and take a look at the esophagus, or that fibromuscular pathway that leads between the pharynx and the stomach. Thank you.